Hey guys, it's Truthman from OverClocking-TV and I've been joined by Tiala from OverClocking-TV as well.
Hi guys, how's it going?
Welcome guys, this will be the Tech Talk Q&A. So basically it's a time for you guys to ask us pretty much any question that you want. It's kind of like a ask me anything kind of thing, we can say.
Kind of like this.
We're going to be having that tonight, tomorrow and the day after tomorrow as well. And for us, it's quite late in the evening. It's already 11 p.m. We'll be doing that for the next hour or so, like 45 minutes, 1 hour.
And, yeah, tonight I think we'll do a shorter one anyway.
Yeah, sure. We are all very tired. We had to set up all the systems here at the campus party. Welcome, guys. Just let us know on the live chat where you are coming from and where you are actually watching this from. We know that our friends at Techmundo are actually displaying the live chat, the live on their website. And there's also the guys at overclock.net that are displaying the live stream as well.
Yeah, actually, so, it's on the front page.
Big shout out to you guys. Thank you very much. And if you're joining, this is we are live from the HWBOT World Tour. That's the first stop of the seasons. And we are here in Sao Paulo in Brazil. So it's quite hot. It's been a long day. We woke up like pretty early this morning just to set up everything.
Well, yeah, I think this morning we woke up, it was what, 6, maybe 5:50, 6 a.m., something like that. Got up, tried to, go through the painful steps of the morning where you wake up, try to get a shower somehow, eat your breakfast, and pack whatever was left in the luggage that was not already there here at the campus party, because yesterday we actually came with most of the stuff. Prepared everything. We came here straight in the morning to get our passes. Those passes, pretty much the VIP passes, but mainly just an exhibitor pass here for the campus party. Take the space on the booth, start setting up everything, and then there was a press conference. So we had to leave the building for security reasons because apparently overclocking is way too dangerous to be staying while the press is around. So
you guys have to leave for the press conference. You guys have to leave.
So what we did, we actually took a trip across Sao Paulo this morning to get some, to say hi to the guys at HyperX, grab some stuff over there and come back here. Yeah. So it was a cool trip to see through the town. I really liked it.
It was fun indeed to discover some other part of the city because for you guys, especially for you, Timothy and Peter, that's the first time you ever come to Brazil and especially to Sao Paulo. So there's some space that there's some area of the city that you actually don't know at all. That's quite fun to see. So basically this show is like, we call that the Tech Talk Q&A, but it's basically like an open talk show. And depending on the time, maybe more in the next few days, we'll have some random guests showing up. That could be people we meet here at the campus party.
Actually, if you want to be guest as well on Skype or say you have something to share, very important. I don't know if you're working on some specific hardware project, if you're working on something overclocking related, something you would like to show to the world. Just drop us a message either at contact@overclockingtv.com or directly to our Twitter account at overclockingtv or on the Facebook page. Facebook.com/overclockingtv.
Well, it's pretty much /overclockingtv on everything.
Yeah, so anyway, just tell us what you want to talk about, if you're available at the times we're doing the tech talk, and yeah, we get you on the live, and it's always a pleasure to have a few guests here and there with us on the stream, so don't hesitate, actually.
If you have any question, you can always ask them to us for the next 4 days using the hashtag HWT2016. Just do that on Twitter and just send that to at OverClocking-TV. We'll check this out on the live feed in the next few days as well. So Tim, we don't have any special stuff for tonight, so it's kind of like an open things for today. What would you consider the first achievement for today?
The first achievement of the day would
be... waking up is not an achievement.
Oh, damn it. Okay, now I have nothing then. Everything went well. It was the hardest thing to do, and thanks to you waking up early and not having a good sleep, I was awake. So, yeah, no kidding. Actually, the achievement of the day was that we had a great time this afternoon. Actually, the whole afternoon, it never stopped. We had a lot of people coming to the booth to register for the workshops that will start tomorrow. The registration is pretty important on an event like Campus Party because there's 8,000 people there. So it's not like it's just like you're going to show up to the workshop and say, hey, when is the next one? Well, actually, the next one is going to be in 6 hours from now because you haven't registered, right? So the earlier people arrive registered to a workshop, the earlier they get a spot. And of course, because it's a competition as well with the World Series for Amateurs after that, there's some prizes to win. So there's a lot of people interested. And they want to see if they're better than their friends that also take on the workshop. So, you know,
that's actually one thing we see quite often at the World Tour is that people want to, you know, fight against their friends. So they came like four or five people at once and says, oh, I want to know if I'm better than this guy.
We even had some people like actually a few minutes ago, they came. It was a group of four. They come from the south of Brazil. And they've never been to Sao Paulo, never been to the Campus Party. And they were asking if the World Series competition was a team competition straight away. The guys, they don't know anything about overclocking, but they wanted to be making it as a team through it. So because yeah, it actually really looks at it like any other gaming tournaments here. It's like you have one main system for the teaching, but then you have five systems for the actual workshops. So it does look like you could do some team matches. Yeah.
Well, you could do basically like a team match, like 5% of the same computer, but. You need to agree on it.
If we had 10 machines, we could do team matches of 5. No problem. You just sum up the XTU scores.
And do like the sum of the XTU scores or the average of them, or...
You could do whatever you want,
Couldn't it actually be fun to do like the... Like at least like 3 versus 3? And you just, sum up all the scores.
And then you can make some kind of weird, like some kind of fold cards that the people draw. So at the beginning of every kind of match... there's some stack of cards, you pick one card and one of them might be, hey, remove one memory module. Tough shit. So yeah, I mean, like, there's a lot of ways indeed to make overclocking as a team sport interesting. But anyway, that is not the purpose. Like I was saying, the highlight of the day was that we had a lot of people subscribing for the workshop. And tomorrow now we have like already more than... I think almost 60 people already in the queue for tomorrow's workshop. So it's gonna
So that's pretty much like 6 hours. Easily filled for that.
Like I say, yeah, until 7 p.m. tomorrow, it's actually completely full. So
that's quite awesome. The event just started and it's already full in the schedule. That's actually quite insane. What would be okay for my side? The achievement of the day was not falling asleep,
which you performed pretty well at, I have to say,
and making sure that the stream system worked straight when we boot it.
Yeah,
because usually we always have issue with the stream system. Something doesn't work, or something is broken, or the Windows install is fucked up. Or
but thanks for you, I had prepared the OS. I configured the whole streaming software for you. So in the end,
I did nothing. That's pretty much what you're saying.
You did a great job at putting a CPU on a motherboard and.
I didn't even put the CPU.
CPU was already in there, so just the VGA.
I basically plugged the VGA and the cooler on it, like.
The memory kits and the capture cards. Yeah. No, but anyway, it doesn't matter. You did a great job at it for sure. And you had two shows already, so that's pretty cool. Actually, if you guys missed the opening show of the World Tour, you can check on the YouTube channel. On the youtube.com/user/overclockingTV, but I'm pretty sure if you do
youtube.com/overclockingTV
works as well. And you will see there's the replay of the opening show. So that was with Truffman and Fabio from Techmundo. So
we did two shows today. We did the first one that is the official HWBOT World Tour kickoff.
Exactly.
So
yeah.
That was with Peter, and we did actually launch the official season for 2016 for the World Show. So there's going to be like 7 events, 5 continents, one big championship, like with the workshop, the gathering, and the competition happening at these events. So that was the first, like the kickoff, like announcing everything for this 2016 year. And then after that, we had the official launch of this event at the Campus Party, the HWBOT World Tour Latin America. And it was actually with Fabio, and that was something great. That would actually be my achievement for today, because that was the first time ever we did a live stream in two languages. So we were doing English and Portuguese at the same time. Obviously not speaking at the same time, but...
I have to admit, I didn't watch it, so... No, but yeah, I will watch the replay just like everybody on this stream, I hope. And I will tell you what I think of it.
I think the replay is already available on our YouTube channel.
Yeah, I know. That's what I'm saying. I'm going to watch it. It's one thing at a time.
But okay. that was actually quite fun to do, and we will be doing that more and more for the next few days as well. So, what could we talk about? So, what did you see at the campus party here that would interest you? Well, we didn't have much time to go around though.
You know what's interesting with campus party is so it's the kind of people you meet here is very, very broad. You know, sometimes you go to LAN parties and the type of people you find there are mainly people that play video games and are really just into playing games together or individually or like that kind of person. But when you go to campus party, it's very, very wide. It goes from I saw some people that came here to play World of Warcraft. You know, they just come here to play World of Warcraft. Okay.
There's still people playing WoW.
Well, yeah, I also saw people playing League of Legends. I saw, and then there's some people that do case modding behind us. So there's like actually quite a few people that come here to present their case mod to people that enjoy checking out case mod. They it's just like when you see car racing, you know, when they all stop before and they're all opening.
Check out my car.
Well, yeah, check out my car. Like, check out my PC, right? And it's actually pretty cool, you know. People ask, you know, oh, hey, how you did that? Oh, it's pretty cool here. The pipes you've got. Hey, what liquid you use for your water cooling or etc. And then there's also a lot of developers, coders, people that like to write code and hack things. There's some 3D printing. We've also have some artists that do. Anything on the computer, of course, so people that do that offer to provide a logo service or that offer to provide a design service for whatever reason, so you can go see them and they help you out with your design needs. There's also, of course, the conferences, which is another of the really big parts I really like here.
But I guess the conferences will be more tomorrow than today.
It starts tomorrow, yeah. So we didn't so much today besides the opening keynote, which was mainly like a crowd warm-up kind of thing, where everyone was shouting and cheering.
Pretty much like, go on the scene and then make people shout very, very loud. We did actually have to postpone by 5 minutes at the beginning of the live because
yeah,
it was way too noisy.
It's good, like, you know, people are really excited, and I think now almost 8,000 people are here. One of the big conferences that are going to be here will be the VP of Facebook talking. There will be, some very famous people from the Brazilian community of either science or technology. People I absolutely don't know, so I could not say their name. The list is actually pretty long. They have different stages. There's some for design, some for culture, some for not biotechnology, but any kind of technology in general. There's behind there was Expo. There's a huge startup area where people can present their startups. They have some small competition. You can win some prizes. Most of the time for startups, they're looking for cash. So the price is some cash, but it can be also some opportunities to meet venture capitals, etc. So it's quite diverse. There's everything here, you know. Campus party, if it's the place you need someone to help you with your hacking for hardware, and you need some guy to code to help you code some web interface for your project, and then you want to learn overclocking, you can do it too, and etc. It's possibilities are endless.
And that is the biggest technology-related event in South America. Mexico is like Central America, pretty much. So I know that only Mexico is a bit bigger, right?
It's bigger in attendance, but the Mexico LAN party has no camping. No, it has a camping, but it has no exhibition area. So the organizers say that this one is the largest one in South America. So.
But that's the thing, like, so we have expositions, we have the campus per se area, and we have the camping. So there's people actually sleeping, like, just not next door, but in the same hall as us.
Yeah, but it's gonna be
noisy.
Yeah, I'm actually, I did campus party in Berlin, sleeping in the tents, and well, you know, it's a great experience, especially if you plan to stay late, you know, meet people, chat with people overnight or whatever, or work really hard, really hard with a group of people overnight. But yeah, it's pretty intense. A whole week of almost no sleep because there's noise. You can hear this, these people with the horns. Like, yeah,
they usually start shouting.
It's tough to fall asleep before 2 a.m. and it's tough to not wake up before 6 because people start going to the showers at that time. So the nights, whatever you can get from the nights, are really short. And I already saw people sleeping on the tables before, so. Because, you know, people travel a long way to come here. Brazil is a huge country.
Yeah, it's extremely huge. Do you have a news, like a hardware-related news from this week that share with the viewers?
Oh, hardware news. Let me see.
Actually like one. Like, ASRock have to back up on the non-K overclocking.
Yeah, so that stands from it started at CES, right? When they every vendor launched their refresh boards. So the Z170X, most of them.
It's not Z170X, it's X170.
Yes, X.
So the X series,
yeah. And they had this feature that was the Sky OC feature, and I think.
Oh, that's what it means. I was thinking like it was. Overclock to the sky or something like this. I didn't even understand that word joke was like the Sky Lake OC.
Anyway, it was okay. Saying that you could overclock Sky Lake on those motherboards. So they had, they had to back off a little bit on that.
So basically they claim that they allowed that on all their motherboard pretty much. And now, like, I think that was like today or yesterday, they had to say like, oh, sorry, that's going to be only happening on Z170 chipset.
Yeah, I think someone passed the phone call, maybe. I don't know. But anyway, it doesn't. Again, you know, there's always rumors like this. And most of the stuff that has been announced at CES anyway is not yet in the shops. So, you know, it's like. A lot of brands announce things at CES and then they see what the response is from the community, but also sometimes what is the response from Intel going to be, or what is the response
from the retailer if they are interested to they place order for it.
Well, exactly. You know, most of them are launching like 30 boards or maybe sometimes less, but usually it's quite a significant amount of boards because people, they have all those different revisions of boards and different layouts and different sizes, etc. So it's a lot of boards, but of course not all of them are going to find orders. So it's going to be like a pretty tough thing to you know, bring your boards to the market. And that's what brands do. They test things out and yeah, not all of them works. That's an example of them, sadly. But yeah, it's okay.
Yeah, after that, that's a personal opinion. But to my opinion, I do think there's way too much products queue on the market. So that means that, to my opinion, there's way too many way too many products on the market for one brand, for the same brand. Sometimes, like even the Z170 chipset. So just taking this one, Z170, that's supposed to be like the high end of the mainstream. Like most of the manufacturers, they have like maybe 5 different boards for it. Like one that is gaming, one that has a special color scheme, one that is micro ATX, one that is mini ATX. And then they have like one with encryption, one without encryption. And there's some needs for this. Like, for example, the encryption. I talk about that one because I did some research on it. The only reason why they do the exact same board, it's the exact same board with and without the encryption, is because they cannot sell hardware encryption device in some countries. For example, in Russia, stuff like that, they cannot sell it.
There's also a lot of different versions of motherboard, and sometimes it's just because something inside the bundle is changing. Like you say, it's not allowed in some countries. It's exactly the same with Wi-Fi. The bands, the legal bands allowed are different. So if you are in Israel, if you are in the US, or if you are in Europe or in China, it's different. And well, you know, it's the same motherboard, but the bundle being different, you know. Sometimes.
And you can start creating the motherboard, put the bundle in there, but doesn't have the FCC approval for selling that in some countries. So
you quickly end up with 30 like or more revision, like packages of somehow the similar kind of motherboard. That's how it is.
And it's not even talking about revision, about the few different BIOSes and so on. So I guess that we had one question from the chat.
Yep.
So what was the question?
Let me pull the chat.
Okay. Okay. Question from DWS6969. Nice nickname, by the way. If you had to speculate, how do you think the new AMD Polaris GPU will hold on overclocking? Well, so first of all, we need to say like the Polaris GPU. Well,
it's not
yet out, so that's only gonna be rumors, and that's gonna be only be speculations. We had no samples. It's so far AMD just announced stuff, but we have nothing yet, and it's supposed to be a new architecture as well.
It's fourth generation, they say. It's arriving apparently mid 2016 if everything is on time and etc. Supposedly it's a big big improvement, as every marketing slide would ever tell you anyway.
Oh, we are launching this brand new thing, but there's nothing changing from the previous one.
Hey, everyone has to sell their stuff, right? It's normal. Anyway, it's always up to the reviewers to tell you what they think on the day of the launch. It has optimizers, implementation of FinFETs, etc., etc. Well, on the paper, it all looks nice. Again, overclocking-wise, sometimes it doesn't really correlate with what is announced as a stock kind of
Well, if I had to be honest, I guess that we will be a little bit limited according to the latest GPU that AMD launched with HBM. Like the memory is actually so close to the actually on the same kind of die pretty much, and this was a big factor of non being able to overclock that for the first few months, and then after that people find a way around to try to overclock that.
But still, find a way around.
Still, we know that when we do overclocking, especially with the graphic cards, the GPU, the main core can always go stronger in volts and everything, and the memory is usually the most difficult part to touch, especially when you go liquid nitrogen and very deep, very low in temperature.
Oh yeah, the heat difference is one of the tricky things to manage with when you're running a GPU overclocking anyway. Which is why some vendors came up with solutions to keep the memory warm to begin with, right? So,
actually, that's true. That was Asus on the Matrix that did the heater.
Yeah, EVGA has also
EVGA
solutions. EVGA
has the same thing
heat.
On the classified.
Classified
or the Kingpin edition. Well, one of maybe the two. I can't remember.
I'm not sure which one, but anyway, there's this feature because it is useful. After the implementation is different from one brand to the other, but the idea is the same, to keep the memory warm while your GPU is below zero or something like that. So,
well, once again, that's not going to be the main use of people, right?
Well, no, it's not the main use, but that's what we are interested about. So,
not being like everyone else.
Hey, we don't care, you know, if you're going to run like Age of Empire on your graphics card from next
year. Age of Empire 2 HD.
Yeah, so actually, if you're watching this and if you have been playing Age of Empire, tell us which ones were your favorite cheat code on Age of Empire.
Oh, mine was Popo to have the baby guns.
What was it on the first one or on the Age of Empire?
Age of Empire 2.
Two,
I think that was like Popo, and you had like a baby on the trailer appearing and you can shoot with guns.
You had the Cobra car as well. The one where it was some kind of black Cobra car, I guess, with two guns on the side.
Oh, yeah.
And you could, of course, have millions of units of this one. It was not really fun anyway, because once you had it, you were sure to win anyway. But yeah, it was good old times.
That's the thing. Like Age of Empire 2, I remember I was always creating like homemade maps when everyone start in corners, with like a lot of resources there, like a lot of gold, a lot of minerals,
yeah,
and so on.
So you pass through the ages very quick without having to lose time moving.
That's the thing. And then you have to either cut the forest or smash it with the catapults to go and fight the other guy. And in the middle, you still have more gold and more resources and so on. That is retarded to play like this, but it was fun.
I remember, Age of Empire, well, my PC back then was struggling mainly with the map, the map mode, the map creation mode. It was not struggling so much with the game itself, but the map creation mode was pretty intense on the I'm the graphics guy, I remember. Yeah, well, I still had a Pentium 1 and 16 megabytes of graphics cards. You know, it's the time,
far from what we have now.
It's to tell you, it's at the time where no one was caring how fast your GPU was going. It was not important because anyway, you didn't have enough memory.
Okay, moving on to the next topic, DIY and modding. So what would you say you see this trend going? Because there's a lot of things going on with like the makers and modders lately.
DIY and modding. Actually, we should, you know what? For the occasion, let me bring up the picture we've taken already here at the World Tour of all the
these parts, so I can show the screen.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't want you guys to see all the people I have on my Facebook.
Your trackpad is absolutely terrible.
I need to get used to it. No, you need to click on the cursor and then
we're getting there, guys.
Turn off chat. Turn off chat. All friends. Okay. Yeah. Can you?
Can I hide it or what?
I have no idea, actually.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. So now I can show the screen. Okay. So now we can show you the screen.
Okay. Well, just some picture of Campus Party up.
So these are the pictures you can find on the official HWBOT page. So that's facebook.com/HWBOT.
Those are just some pictures of the case mod I took. And so yeah, your topic, DIY and modding. And yes, it's something actually, you know what? Modding is something that used to be pretty big from my remembering back in the years 1998 to 2002. I remember. Actually, that's how I got into overclocking to begin with. I was modding my terrible Pentium 1 that was looking like nothing, and I had I didn't have LEDs, but I had those, you know, neon tubes you had back in the days.
I remember. You had the small one like 9 centimeters, and you have the longer one like 40
centimeters.
Yeah,
and you could buy some of different colors. Of course, the blue ones that were always the expensive ones, and you had those starters that you had to were breaking.
But blue is always better, so it was okay.
Yeah. So modding now is coming. It's not coming back. It's actually back since quite a few years. But the way it's back, it's a very, very artistic. It's
like professional way. It looks very good now.
It's very pro and very, very developed modes. And of course, one of the main difference now with modding is that before you were doing nice mod around the ugly motherboard. And now, since then, you know, the motherboards now are actually pretty cool. You have all those LED features, of course.
It's all black and red.
Yeah, no, not all of them. All motherboard is black and it has a white chipset.
Actually, the black and white, I really like it.
Anyway, you know, it's like there's choice for every type of color you want to find. And there's some very nice haste braiders. You have the IO shields, etc., etc. So people are building a lot of really cool mods. That's another mod I saw there. It's actually a girl.
I didn't saw that one, and they repaint the cover for the all-in-one cooler.
Yeah, the paint job I would say is not the best in the world, because you can see there's some little things here and there, but it's not that easy to paint, so I'm not judging anything. I think there was this one which was pretty cool. I'm not sure what the electronic on top was. There was some Android and some stuff, and so there was some kind of display going on there.
Or maybe to control all the LEDs inside.
Yeah. Oh, one thing I have to say is that here everything was, this whole area is sponsored by CUDA Master. So that's why everyone is using the same case, the master case.
That's actually the main case they're promoting.
Well, since Computex last year. This one is actually pretty cool. See, the picture looks better like that because when you look at it, the cyber stuff is kind of like animated and things. That one is a very good one. That's another one also that was more like retro style. What's hilarious is the the extinguisher bottle on the top. Always nice. That's the same view of the previous case from the other side. This one actually pretty cool as well, the Thor case. So this one is, I guess, built on a TT case, I suppose, because it says TT Thor. Very nice as well. There's the pipes coming out like this in the middle. A little more close up.
Oh, the cosmos?
Yeah, of course. You see it actually in every modding exhibition. This case is ultra famous as well. This time is running four matrix cards in there. Pretty cool. Yes, there are some girls interested in modding.
Cool.
Of course. Actually, some case mods are made by girls there. And there was this figure, and I don't know what it's for. OCTV. My password is OCTV, guys. Now you know. But you have to come steal my laptop first. So.
I see that all the training and the discussion we had about the security, did work well.
Actually, thing is, when I go to events, I always put a shitty password. Like this, when someone, like in that case, needs to access my laptop, it's easier to say that my 16-character user password.
That was like minors and caps and...
It's a kind of password that you can't type on most of the keyboards.
Yeah, I have the same issue because you have some special characters.
Yeah, you always search for it and you have to do shift and sometimes you even have to do
the alt thing.
It's like, yeah, that way you get to there, so... also, and then after that, it's just some picture of the opening ceremony. But
I guess we're gonna see more and more, more stuff during the next few days, because we didn't have that much time to go around everything. And the event officially opened only at 8 p.m. today. We are here since this morning because we had to set up the booth, but before that, it was not officially open. So there's still people arriving. I think before this live, like 45 minutes ago, I was. Going a little bit around with Peter looking for some decent food. I say decent food because we were actually looking for a salad.
Oh, you are trying to be healthy, really?
Well, the cochinillas are great, but I won't eat like two of them each day. Huh?
Let's explain what a cochinilla is.
Oh, what is the cochinilla? Yeah. Cochinilla is one of the... try to find a picture on Google. So the cochinilla is like something like you have chicken around mashed potatoes and it's deep fried. It's super, super tasty. It's super cool. I love that. But it's, let's say you won't do like a full week eating that. Huh? So that's how it looks.
It looks a little bit like a samosa, actually.
But samosa is made out with some...
Yeah, yeah, you have potatoes and peas, etc. And you have no meat usually in there. It's actually pretty good. I have to say, not everything is cochinilla in there, but your trackpad really sucks. I stopped touching.
So these are the cochinillas. So that's a very Brazilian meat. There's some stuff that we need to try as well, but I didn't find them here, like pastéis. It's kind of like a deep fried croque monsieur, friand.
Yeah.
So that's gonna be good to try out some stuff. So for Timote and Peter, that's the first time they come to Brazil. So that's all brand new for them. I actually went there once before, like 2 years ago.
Yeah.
When I was here in Sao Paulo 2 years ago, so I know some of the special stuff, but I know that this is really good, but I won't eat that every day.
It's like most of the good things. If you abuse it, they abuse a few.
We're actually making fun with Peter. It's like, oh shit, we have to go training tomorrow morning. And for what? Just because you can eat one more tomorrow?
Yeah, exactly. That's how it works. Hey, Dan Cup on the chat. So Dan Cup is an overclocker from Germany, actually, who's going to be a guest for the competition, if I'm correct.
For the competition commentary on Saturday for the HWBOT World Series, Dan Cup would be with us, doing the discussion and giving his extreme overclocker opinion on it. He's actually number one in the world, so that's going to be the best one to comment on that.
Definitely going to be a very valuable advice. And actually, I would recommend anyone that is going to compete on the next day to eventually watch the stream to maybe get some hints on what you're supposed to do.
That would be actually a good...
Especially on XTU, because Dan Cup is actually pretty expert on XTU.
Yeah, I think he was benching tonight. He told me he was benching... Oh, yeah, he was benching Super Pi 32M in Cinebench. Well, it seems like he got some decent scores, so we can't wait to see that to be posted online and on HWBOT for it. Going back to the DIY and modding things,
yes.
To me, the biggest change I saw is it's becoming more professional. So the mods are becoming much, much more polished, more finished. And it's a big, big change in the water cooling theme as well, because water cooling was going down and then it picked up with all the modding going back again.
I think what brought mod water cooling always kind of was tricky, especially back in the days, I would say. But I mean, like, that for water cooling, there has been a before and a after AIOs, right? Like AIOs, like all-in-one water coolings, is really what brought water coolings to the regular users.
Yeah, back to mainstream.
And the thing is that once you start with an AIO and you're really actually into building your own PC, etc., well, once you reach the limit of it, the next logical step anyway is to build your own homemade water cooling, and the solutions have actually evolved quite a bit. Like EK is making some awesome water blocks, but there are also some other brands that are doing some very good ones. The mountings for mountings, the pipe, etc., has improved a lot. Now you have also like
even
all those mounts.
Even the piping, you have the no very like light one, and you have the hard tubing as well.
You had the hard tubing, which you can also bend to how you want it. You have tubings. Yeah, I mean, like even the liquid and all the coloring, etc., it's a lot better. Like back in the days, if you want to color your liquid for your water cooling, you ended up always having some stuff, you know, in there, and it was not really cool.
It's good, and actually most of the Ks now support water cooling. Not now, it's been years, but
it's been
all
years.
All the Ks support water cooling, even the cheapest one do support water cooling. So it's like it's good to see that trend going. No.
Yeah, plus it starts to be quite a few modding competitions as well. Like there's some tournaments here and there. Most of them, that's a personal opinion, but sadly most of them are invitationals. And I would like to see something more like you see for any artistic sport. So that would be an artistic esport where you would have a jury of let's say some famous modders that are not into the competition anymore, but also combined with some industry people, etc., some people that have experience,
and maybe someone that have no clue whatsoever and just give his opinion on
it. Some people from the press, etc. Anyway, to have a jury that will be giving a mark for every mod, and you would have a competition like this. And for example, it would be like, I don't know, lasting for a few days, and you would have to do some specific modes with different requirements.
Here is the case, here's the motherboard, here's the setup.
Yeah.
And you can do everything you want, but in 3 days you are being judged.
Yeah. Or even not that, you could do it at home, it doesn't matter. You bring it there and you're judged on different criteria, right? You're judged on the paint job, you're judged on the whatever cable stuff you did. You're judged on the water cooling and how you did that. You're judged
on the ID behind it.
Yeah, I mean, like, it's just the exact same way you have competitions on TV for how to make nice cakes, you know? And yet it's exactly that. You know, they judge on the taste of the cake. You cannot really taste the PC, but anyway.
They also judge on the presentation of the plates.
Yeah, yeah, of course. So, I mean, like, there's plenty of ways you could make modding not invitational and make it open to everyone that wants to go in. And that's it, you know. And then whoever gets the highest mark just wins, and that makes it a lot more cool. An event like this, where people bring their own mods, totally the right place to do it.
Damn, that's good idea. So let's try to do that next maybe.
HWBOT is not that much into making modding competitions.
OCTV,
but
OCTV neither, but we can maybe help some people with what we know how to do the live stream to do that. Anyway, there was another question from DWS6969. Any chance we will see some tutorials on the channel in the future that could explain some concept and how to overclocking, etc.? The answer is yes, big time, and that's going to be tomorrow and the day after tomorrow. So basically tomorrow we start at 6 p.m. local time, so that's GMT minus 2. I think that's like 3 hours up front of the Eastern time zone in the US. So 6 p.m. GMT minus 2, we will have the opening, like the day opening, so basically like talking what happened during the day. And then after that, we'll have the amateur training. So all the people that doesn't know how to overclock and that come here at the HWBOT World Tour event that get trained for it, you're going to have the same training online. So we'll actually put the mic and get the feed from the computer from one of the trainer, and you will be able to see it. We will produce that in English and in Portuguese. And yeah, we can extend that because pretty much all the guys will be doing like the training, and I can answer some of your questions as well on the side. And yeah, then we'll have all the some stuff about the safety training when you want to do extreme overclocking. That's something we usually do at least once during the event, because like the people use the equinitrogen, and a lot of people actually ask us, hey, is that dangerous? Can I use that 24/7? Like all these kind of questions. So yeah, tomorrow 6 p.m. That's gonna be 6 p.m., 7:30 p.m., and 8:30 p.m. Oh, there you go.
And hi Sokolone, if that's how you pronounce your nickname, welcome on the chat. And
hey Sokolone, that guy is actually here quite often during the streams. Actually, he did. I think he won something in one of the last stream we did.
Hey Dan Cobb, you could see Truth benching many times. It's always not efficient, but he's benching.
Well, when I'm benching, I spend like 8 hours installing Windows and then 30 minutes benching XTU.
Then it's time to go to bed.
Question from Raul Victor Cohen. Yes, that will be here at the campus party. So if you are at the campus party, you can come see us tomorrow. Actually, you can come see us now and register for the workshop, or you can come tomorrow or the day after tomorrow for the training. And on the live, if you're not here at the campus party, we will do that on the live, and we'll do it once in English and once in Portuguese tomorrow and the day after tomorrow as well. So here or not here, you will have the training in the same stuff.
Yeah.
That guy is asking where he can see me benching.
Yeah. Like I would say, you won't believe what you will see. Truth started benching, and you won't believe what happened next.
Nothing.
Yeah, we're looking forward to have you on board. Dan Cup is going to be a really cool competition.
I can't wait for Sunday. Well, last topic for tonight. Trends in hardware used in stats. So do you see a lot of people using Skylake CPUs lately? Especially when we look at the score on HWBOT. So all the top scores are made on Skylake.
Yes, well, of course, the latest generations of CPUs is of course always making the best scores. Like, I mean, it's normal. Every CPU is an improvement, and it's not been quite a while anyway that Intel releases worse CPUs than the previous one. That doesn't really happen, right? So,
well, there's at least 3% increase at least.
Yeah, of course, X99 platform is still very present in the rankings, but for everything else, Skylake is definitely there, and especially now we are seeing Skylake CPUs going really, really high in frequency, like a lot higher than anyone would have predicted a while ago. So, I mean, like even Dan Cup on the chat has one of the best Skylake CPUs in the world. He can tell us how fast this one is going. Or you can check his HWBOT page, like hwbot.org/user/DanCup, and you will see how fast his CPU is going. So actually, those CPUs are going really high. I'm not sure about the whole HWBOT statistics.
We should ask Peter to get some statistics for that. Well, if you want to raise.
We can confirm that tomorrow. Yeah. But there's still people using, of course, the other one. And 4770K, for example, has been the most popular CPU for ages, and it probably still is. A lot of people still use this CPU, and there's a lot of there's more and more competitions at HWBOT where you don't really need to have the latest Skylake either to be able to participate and at least enter the different draws and different possibilities of winning. So, you know, those CPUs are still very, 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 very used. And also there's the fact that Skylake hasn't been really available in many places in the world.
Yeah, I was actually going to comment on that. Like, it's getting difficult and expensive to get Skylake CPU.
Skylake CPUs always was expensive straight from the start. It's just what we see compared to the other chips is that the other CPU releases used to go, you know, have a small like drop in price after a little while, and Skylake right now hasn't really dropped anything, and it's still for some people hard to find. Motherboard availability, on the other hand, is really, really easy to find everywhere. So
seems that we got some lost connection. So I guess that's the time we're gonna close the show.
If you lost the connection, guys, and you see us again and you think you missed something, always make sure to check out the replays on YouTube. They are posted usually quite a few minutes after it's done, so just check it out. And
we'll be posting that video on the YouTube channel as well. That's something like completely wide open in the topics, so we don't have stuff to prepare, so we're going to be doing that tomorrow evening and the next day as well. So I think that's going to be it for today. The next show will be tomorrow. We're going to start at 6 p.m. local time. So go on overclocking-tv.com to find out what are the other time zones. And thank you, Timothy, for being with me here.
You're welcome. My pleasure.
And I guess that now is going to be a packing time and trying to find a salad and go to bed.
Yeah, it's 11:55. It's time to sleep.
Well, thank you guys for being here. If you have any questions, you can always ask them on Twitter with the hashtag HWT2016, or just ask your question at OverclockingTV, and we will be answering them tomorrow evening in the next Tech Talk Q&A, or ask us anything, Q&A things. Thank you, Timothy.
Thanks,
Drew. Thank you to you guys, the viewers. See you tomorrow. Oh, not this one.